like you should not kill, things like you should not lie, right? So what my colleagues were talking about, they said, you know, they were saying, and you know, they were showing from your references that Muhammad broke every single one of those laws. Not only did he break them, he actually commanded through Islam his followers to break the laws. So my question to you then was, why are you following the Prophet? Like, I asked you first of all, do you agree with the Ten Commandments? You know, they seem to be normal things, even if you're not religious, they're normal conducts by which everybody should live by. You shouldn't lie, you shouldn't steal someone's wife, you shouldn't kill somebody, you shouldn't take adultery, sleep, rape, or sleep with people that are married. But yet, we see Muhammad did everything. So now, we now came back to the point of Muhammad stealing his son's wife. Yeah, so Muhammad stole his son's wife because Allah in Sura 33.
He's given to him, yes.
Allah in Sura 33 ordained it. You know, said, you know, we wanted you, Muhammad, to lust after her. We wanted you to. We caused the divorce. We caused your attraction to your son's wife, so that people can marry their adopted son's wives. And then later on, Allah then says, oh, by the way, adoption is not allowed.
Yeah.
So Surah 33:4, I think. But I need to get the correct number. But yeah, go on. That's my.
Okay.
So answer my question. Why are you following a prophet that allows you, commands you to actually break every single one of God's basic, very basic laws?
Okay, so first of all, what you said was, they broke up the partnership because God wanted to, he created the lust for him, yes? That was to clarify, to show the distinguished difference between a son and an adopted son. Okay? Like he said it in the thing, I did that so people can see the difference in the adoption when I read that verse, the second to last line. Okay? And then you said there was no such thing, adoption is not allowed in Islam. Do you know the hadith, the truth hadith, you find this as well in Bukhari Muslim. It's the one where it says, in heaven, he who adopts, a yatim, we call this an orphan, okay? He who adopts an infant, or an orphan, sorry, will be like this with Prophet Muhammad. That's what Prophet Muhammad said. So how is it you can say one thing here and another thing there? That just shows. He himself was an orphan. I don't know if you know that, Prophet Muhammad.
Yeah, he was an orphan.
He was an orphan. That's to show the priority of orphans. An orphan was chosen as the best of all mankind for his Muslims. Okay? And then he goes, for everyone in the future, the hadith, he goes on when he's older, he who adopts an orphan will be like this with me. Then he did the symbol of his hand, sewing it closed, so he'll be together in paradise. How can he say that when, if then it's revealed in the Quran that you can't do this? But he only ever said what was revealed to him.
Okay. Are you finished?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're still not answering my question. Okay. The story of Zayd and Zainab goes, according to the hadiths, yeah, right? That Surah of the Prophet, the Bible of the Prophet. Muhammad went to visit Zayd. Muhammad saw Zainab. Zayd wasn't around. Zainab was a bit naked. Muhammad saw her and became attracted to her. Right? Zainab then tells.
It's a week or two. It's a week or two.
I'm not sure.
I'll translate.
Contradicting this, but this is how the story goes. Zainab then goes to her husband to say Muhammad desired her. The husband then gets embarrassed and then divorces, offers her divorce, right? Muhammad says, no, don't divorce her. But this is the point, whether it's a weak hadith or not, it comes then in the Quran, it shows up in the Quran. Surah 33, 37. I'm going to read it.
Oh no, it changes everything, but yes, carry on.
No, it doesn't, because the Quran confirms it, unless you're rejecting the Quran.
It confirms not for that reason.
Yes, it does, because this is what the Quran says. The Quran says, and when you said to him, Zayd, on whom Allah has bestowed grace, and you have done favor, keep your wife to yourself. Right? So, Muhammad says, so you can read along with me if you want. So he says, when you said to him, keep your wife to yourself and fear Allah. you should fear him. So when Zayd had accomplished his desire for her to divorce her, we gave her to you in marriage so that there may be no difficulty to the believers in respect of their wives, of their adopted sons, when they have a desire to keep them. So in other words, Allah is saying that, look, we're the one that ordained for you
for
to
what desire. Reason?
The point is, Allah said, we are the one that put that desire, which the Bible says lost. So Allah is saying, I put the...
2020.
Do you want to come this one? So let me just quickly summarize. So Allah is saying, I was the one that put that lustful desire in your heart to desire her. I was the one that caused the divorce so that you can have the her. But what I'm saying, this negates every single one of the Ten Commandments. This negates God's law. Because God said, don't steal your neighbor's wife. Don't take someone else's wife. Jesus said, even if you look at somebody with lust, you've already committed adultery. So Jesus even says that you don't even look at someone's wife desiring them. If you don't do anything, if you just have a desire for them, that's you lusting after them. But yeah, Allah comes and says, oh no, we're the one that put that lust in your heart. We're the one that caused someone's divorce. So you can go ahead, take her, you know, so that everybody else that lust after their son's wife can have them. How does that make sense to you? What does that sound okay to you?
Can you read to me the second to last line again, please? Why he did that?
Yeah, it says, we gave her to you in marriage so that the wives of their adopted son, when the latter have no desire to keep them, they have divorced them, and Allah's commands must be fulfilled so that people could then marry their adopted son's wives.
That's the thing. To show that the difference that we have between son and adopted son. Like we talked earlier about when he changed Zayd's name to his name.
Yeah.
And then Allah was like, no. When it comes to adoption, you can take care of them and everything, but give them the name that belonged to them. Okay? He said another thing to distinguish between now of a son and adopted son.
So the point is, Allah caused someone's divorce.
Did he not provide him in the future?
Allah caused lust. Allah caused someone's divorce so that everybody else can have married their adopted
education for someone else.
Yeah, and even though Allah later on says you're not even allowed to adopt anyway because of this incident.
So that's the thing. From what I said earlier, does that not show to you that you can and how the importance of adopting orphans?
Let me look for the reference. So you don't see anything wrong with Allah causing, you know.
It's a lesson.
Whether it's a lesson or not, it's a coveted. Can you not see that this goes against the God of the Bible?
Imagine
it's
if we
never
had that
okay
lack of clarity.
To steal somebody. It's never okay to lust. That's God's standard.
Something that was will.
It's never
teach
okay.
Teach a whole population, teach mankind, to know, to show the clarity of what it is we can or can't do. Imagine living in a time where there is no objective moral compass.
Okay.
That's what that is. That provides us with an objective moral compass to tell us what we can and we cannot do. If there was a lack of certainty around a certain situation, which is what's going on right now, when there's so much subjectivity, that ruins people, and that's why there was so much deviation from the Christianity to the Christian religion. That's why you had different sects, different everything. That's why the word of Islam has been preserved, because it made sure everything was done for a reason to educate people.
So one thing to you, Allah and Muhammad makes illegal what the God of the Bible makes illegal. In other words, what Muhammad came to do was to say it's okay to sin, even though God says this is my law, you will not break my law, and this is a sin. But what then Muhammad does is what exactly you're doing. You're justifying sin. Because of what? Because of Muhammad's example. It's simple and plain. If you see somebody's wife, if someone's married to someone, God hates the Bible.
He didn't see them. Situation.
They were married. Were they married or not?
What was the context of it? How did it come in?
Where
did he just go into the house and hide them? Where were you?
No, he came to visit them, but then he saw her naked.
Yes.
And then desired her, which is called lust.
Sin to be in a situation like that. And then trying to get out of it.
Okay, let's see what the Bible says. Lust, Jesus says, even if you look at somebody's wife without committing it, but you look at them lustfully, you desire them in your heart, you have committed adultery.
He didn't look up. Then he felt lust. If you're saying the use of your hadith, yes.
The last because he decided he saw the wife, and if he stops there, I will even understand if he stopped there. Then Allah then goes, you know, then says, causes divorce. Divorce is a serious thing according to God's law. The Bible says God hates divorce.
True.
So then Allah then
this happened for this reason. For this reason.
Yes.
That's why it was done.
But
then we still lust. When you, even it's still the same. If you look at someone, the wrong intention.
Yes.
If you walk into a situation and it's happened, it's your objective, it's upon you to get out of that situation to avoid it.
Right.
But like when you said, if we're using that hadith, I don't know if it's true or if it's weak. I'm just going on that basis.
No,
why it happened. I'm saying the hadith, you're from Talib or whatever it was.
But what we can agree from this Quran is that Muhammad said, don't divorce. Muhammad desired her.
Yes, that shows his true principles, yes.
But Muhammad initially desired her.
Yes.
Then Muhammad said, don't divorce.
Muhammad said, don't divorce, which shows the principles of a man to say no.
Is that correct for him to say, don't divorce her?
Don't divorce her, but then it was revealed to him for that situation
but then Allah,
to be done so.
Allah comes and even make it worse to say no. To let them go ahead. I was the one that caused the divorce. I was the one that caused your loss. In order for everybody to be able to marry who they desire.
Not who they desire. To distinguish between that. To clarify the difference in
adopted son.
Yes. To show the difference of what it is versus Islam when it comes to adopting and blood.
The point is this. The Quran provides a justification for loss. It provides a justification for adultery.
Lust.
Jesus says, if you lust in your heart, you've committed adultery.
Let me finish my point.
Yes, he did.
Same thing that you said.
Because he desired her.
He desired her, but didn't make a move on her. I can look at someone right now.
That's not the point. The point is this. Allah, according to Surah 33:37, Allah was the one that caused his desire for her. That's what Allah said.
So I'm saying, so not Muhammad.
Yes.
So Muhammad did lust.
Yes, Muhammad did, but Allah caused it.
Okay,
that's what Allah said.
I'm going to take a step.
So do you not hear what I'm saying? What I'm saying to you is that what Islam is doing, look at this. If you were married, are you married?
No.
Okay, your parents married?
Yes.
Okay. If this is not the same situation, but let's say if an uncle or even a friend, let's say if you don't want to use blood relation, or someone that's been in your house, then starts desiring your mom. Is it okay for your mom and dad to then divorce so that your mom can get with that person? Why is it not okay?
Because there's no reason for him to do that. Did you get a lust?
No, okay.
That he did not try to get wrong, because it's simple for him to intentionally do something to break up a marriage.
Why is it simple?
Firm in the Quran who says you can do that.
No, why is it simple for someone to break someone's marriage?
It's not really wrong.
Okay, so your standards are higher. Allah didn't see that it was wrong to break someone's marriage.
No, that's the thing. He did it for a purpose. That's what I'm trying to tell you.
But whatever purpose it is, whatever the purpose, when people go and commit adultery, when people go and have same-sex relationships, when people steal, when people kill, there's always a reason for it. Do you see what I mean?
It's a lot better than because I had the desire to do
something.
Okay,
so let me tell you why this is a wrong reason.
You had to tell me why this is a wrong reason.
So Allah, first of all, makes... sorry, let me look at the reference. Okay, so Allah...
You're going to be WikiLeaks or something.
No, I'm looking for... I read it in the Quran, but I can't remember where. But anyway, Allah tells them, saints, that we've done this so that people can marry their adopted sons.
Mm-hmm.
But yet later, Allah says you're not allowed to adopt.
He doesn't say that.
I need to show you. Do you know the reference? Let me find you the reference. If I show you the reference, are you going to take your word back?
That's the thing, right? I admit to you earlier, I'm not someone who's the most knowledgeable. I can only speak of what I know. I don't try to create any facts up like your friend did over there or any wrong interpretations. When I see something, I look into it. I try and understand it. Like I said, I don't listen to respond, I listen to understand. That's the difference clearly between some people.
Right. So, can I give you the reference before we leave? I definitely read it in the Quran. Well, I need to give. Can I give you the reference before you?
Please compare it to.
But do you see that? What I'm saying, you're justifying a situation.
I'm not justifying. God is justifying something.
Exactly. Allah is justifying where it's okay to lust. Allah is justifying when it's okay to cause a divorce, right? But this is what we're saying, that this is not what the God of the Bible says. The God of the Bible says adultery is not allowed. The only circumstance where adultery is allowed is where there's unfaithfulness in marriage, where there's been sexual immorality. So if someone goes and have sex with someone, they defile the marriage bed. So
that dissolved for a purpose, and the purpose was to teach and to create certainty, not uncertainty.
Right.
Okay.
But why does someone have to marry? Why does Allah give a revelation for someone to marry their adopted son's wives?
Why? It's in there. You ready?
Why is it okay? Yeah. So why is it okay? Why is it okay to cause a divorce? Divorce, plain and simple, divorce is wrong. Right? You've just said with your own mouth that it's not okay for somebody to come and break up your parents' marriage. Right? It's not okay for someone to come and break up your parents' marriage for whatever reason. Right? But yet, you understand, using your own first-hand knowledge, you understand that's not right. But yet, your prophet is saying, in this situation, it's okay. Yet, Allah is saying, I'm causing divorce because just so that people can marry. Out of all the, everybody else, why do you have to take your adopted son, your son's wife? Why is that okay? When the Bible says, do not steal, don't take your neighbor's, let's even say son, it's a neighbor's, don't take anyone's wife. Okay. Divorce, God hates divorce. But yet we have Allah promoting divorce. And you don't see anything wrong with that. Allah gives a justification.
So, look, they got divorced, and they married.
He caused the divorce.
He caused the divorce. So, he can only do it after the divorce. He cannot take him straight away like this.
Yeah, I know, but he caused the divorce. Allah
because
he wants
to teach something. Like, things happen, we don't know what is happening.
Allah caused the divorce.
We don't have the same level of understanding that God does. That's why it's called the all-knowing, the beloved, whatever it is you want to call him, right? That's why. He has a level of understanding we do not know. He does things that we cannot comprehend in our minds. He did this for this reason. He got them divorced to teach, like I said, clarity, to show the distinguishing point between son and adopted son when it comes to the marriage of their wives. Okay?
But later on says that...
There's this thing that... No, it doesn't say that. That's why you're not finding the reference.
I'll find it.
You probably read it from WikiLeaks. I don't know where you found it.
I read it from the Quran.
Then how come you can't find it now?
Because I can't remember.
Okay, then no problem.
I'll find it and we'll put it on the video. But anyway, the point is this... I don't want us to go around this
stuff,
but what I'm saying is that Allah is a different God from the Christian God, because if we use the example of divorce, it's very clear. God hates divorce. It's very clear in the Bible, right? This is the Bible that, this is the same, supposed to be
the Bible
same,
that's been changed
wait,
over time.
Wait, this is supposed to be the same God that Muhammad points to, right? This is the same Torah Muhammad points to say, I believe in you. This is the same Moses that's supposed to be one of the prophets from God, right? And all that consistent teaching from Moses to all the prophets.
Christianity do not go together. There's two things you cannot put together.
Let me finish my point. Consistently, Moses said, don't commit adultery. Okay? Consistently, in the laws of Moses, divorce was not something that God, promoted. Right? Consistently, Jesus says God hates divorce. Except for sexual immorality. Not only that, killing.
What did Muhammad say in this verse?
Allah
said, don't divorce.
Muhammad seemed to have had a better conscience than Allah. Because Allah said,
Allah knew something.
Yeah, Allah said, I am causing you the divorce. Even though Muhammad.
For a reason.
So the point is this, Allah comes and tells, he breaks every single one of the Ten Commandments. The point is, it's not only.
You said Muhammad. Who's breaking the Ten Commandments?
Allah and Muhammad.
But you said Jesus consistently said it. Moses consistently said
yes.
it. Like you just showed the Prophet Muhammad consistently said it.
No, he didn't.
He said, don't divorce her. Well, your own verse, did he not say don't divorce her?
Okay, do you know what? There's something Aisha said. Aisha says to Muhammad, how comes Allah is always quick to fulfill your desires? Do you know that hadith?
No, I don't know that hadith.
Okay, we'll put it in the link for you, right? Aisha said, why is Allah always quick to give you your desire? This is one of many stories where Allah brings a revelation. For example, there's that surah that says, everybody else can have four wives, but you're allowed to have more than four. There's the surah where, there's a story where Muhammad, Aisha and Hafsa, which were one of the two wives of Muhammad, they catch Muhammad in bed with their slave, right? And then apologize, and then they were like, I will never do that again. And Muhammad then apologized and said, I will never do that again, But then all of a sudden, Allah then gives a revelation, Surah 66, saying, it is okay for you to, it's okay for you to sleep with your slave. It was okay for you to sleep. So Aisha Sura 66. We can read it. Sura 66. Not only that, so many revelations.
You have to bring the evidence.
Sura 66.
No, please. I ask you, please, no comment. Yeah? You want to record your souls? That's fine.
All the 11 wives was not enough for Muhammad. He has to take his adopted son or his son's wife. Why?
No, no. You just said,
that doesn't make sense.
You just said something about sleeping with the...
Yes, it's Sura 66.
Be a normal person.
Verse 1.
Each other, if you listen to each other.
Yeah. What
number 4? If you record each other, that's fine.
So read verse 4.
Number 4. Okay, you talked about Aisha, somebody, Prophet Muhammad sleeping, another wife, another woman in her bed.
So
and you bring that?
Yeah, we're having a conversation. If you
no,
wanna,
no,
if you don't
want to... I just continue your conversation.
Yeah.
Why
so
does that bring the evidence?
Video, let's have this conversation.
Why does that bring the evidence?
I will bring
that's
the evidence. I've given you Sura 66.
Verse 4, right?
Yeah.
Can you read that, please? Because I don't see anything about
it. Okay, read it. Read it then.
No, I'm reading it here.
Okay, read it.
I'm saying what it is. If you two turn into repentance to him, your hearts are indeed so inclined. So if you back up each other or against him, truly Allah is his protector. And Gabriel, and righteous one among those who believe, and furthermore, the angels will back him, will back up. What did that say anything about saying it's okay to do that?
Have you read the tafsir of that?
No, I haven't read the tafsir. What's
the
tafsir of that? Whose tafsir is it? I can interpret it right now. I can interpret it now saying...
Okay, read from verse 1. But you know you have to use your tafsir. That's not how... You can't just make it up in your mind. You use Muhammad's interpretation and you use your hadith and you use hadith, your tafsir to interpret the Quran. So... Do you want me to read Jalalain and the hadith as well? I've got a hadith and I've got a tafsir for this verse. How long is that for? We're going to summarize soon, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
We'll summarize soon, but read it. Do you want me to read the interpretation?
Please.
Okay, so this is Jalalain. So you can go, when you go home, look at Jalalain's commentary on this. And I'm going to read a hadith as well, a Sahih hadith as well. So I said Jalalain, O Prophet, when he's interpreting, he said, O Prophet, why do you prohibit what God has made lawful for you in terms of your Coptic handmaiden Maria? When he lay with her in the house of Hafsa, by the fact that this had taken place in her own house and her own bed, by saying she is unlawful for me, seeking by making her unlawful to you to please your wife. And God is forgiving and merciful, having forgiven you this prohibition. I read Sunnah and Nasa'i, volume 4, hadith 3411. It was narrated from Anas that the Messenger of Allah had a female slave with whom he had intercourse, but Aisha and Hafsa would not leave him alone until he said that she was forbidden for him. Then Allah the Mighty and Sublime revealed, O Prophet, why do you forbid that which Allah has allowed for you? Surah 66:1. So in other words, Muhammad feels guilty for sleeping with his slave in his wife's bed, but lo and behold, once again, Allah then reveals the Quran to say, no, you are allowed. So why are you following such a prophet?
What's the problem there?
You don't see a problem with that?
Can I just answer? Firstly, Maria, she was first, she was slave. After she, I don't want to be on video.
We're videoing this, so you need to. If you want to give a response,
no, this is, just listen.
You know
we're having
true.
A conversation. Voice, you're recording voice. That's fine.
Okay.
You don't need to record my voice.
If you don't
want to be firstly, if you're religious, if you're Christian, and you're really a religious person, you should be up on truth. You shouldn't be up on false. Fight with Islam. You shouldn't be lying and deceiving and anything.
Okay,
so if you're
about.
Honest person,
what
you shouldn't
have.
You shouldn't run away from conversation. And you shouldn't run away from discussion. Okay. Firstly, Maria, the one you talked about, she was freed. She was a slave first. She was freed. he married her. Okay? So after he married her, that's after that, Hafsa said something about her, and then that's when he divorced her. So that is that. Firstly,
okay,
he never slept. Firstly,
let me finish.
Let me finish. What my knowledge of being a Muslim.
Where's your source?
Being a Muslim.
I'm bringing your sources.
Okay.
Let me
just finish. Okay, Maria was free. Secondly, she was married. So if she's married, she has her own house and she's no longer a slave. Thirdly, this issue you're just talking about, making lawful and unlawful, what you're talking about here, this was about honey. A honey that one of the wives of the Prophet used to give to the Prophet. Two of the wives of the Prophet, they tried to make it bad for him. They tried to look bad for him. They're always saying like, oh, something smells bad of you. Who is that? And then he said, okay, it's a honey that I drank from so-and-so wife. And from now on, today on, I'm not going to have that honey anymore.
Okay,
so two things are being mixed here.
Where's your reference?
Hold on, one second. Let me just finish. Two things have been mixed here. Firstly, about Maria being a slave. She was no longer a slave. She was Prophet Muhammad's wife. She was freed and he married her. And then when they complained about her, things like that, he divorced her to please them.
Okay.
Secondly, this issue about, what do you call it, lawful and unlawful, this issue is about honey and drinking honey. It's
can
not
you give
about
me the reference? Wait, yeah, I've
thank
just
you.
Read
okay,
the reference. Wait. I've just read the reference, right? I've read the tafsir of this verse. Right? I've read your hadith. Okay? It doesn't mention honey anywhere.
Okay.
It mentions that Muhammad was sleeping.
You think everything you found on the internet is true?
Wait, this is not internet. This is from your tafsir. This is from your tafsir.
Yeah,
go and check it yourself.
You don't know.
Hang on, wait.
Okay.
Please. I've given you a reference, so if I'm lying, you can go back and check it yourself. I've said, Tafsir Jalalain on Surah 66, I've said, Sunnah An-Nasa'i, volume 4, hadith number 3411.
Okay.
It says, Muhammad was caught with his slave, Mary the Coptic, on his wife's bed.
Mary the Coptic, yeah.
Yes. On his wife's bed. It doesn't mention anything about honey. Can you give me the reference where it talks about honey, please?
Okay,
give me the reference,
much.
Please.
Bring the chapter. Let me just bring the chapter. You're holding it. She's holding it right there. The actual chapter she's holding, I was going to look for it. But alhamdulillah, it's good. We have it right here. Tahrim. Chapter of the, what do you call it, prohibition.
Because we don't want the video long, I might summarize and then carry on the
same. I've lost someone.
So we can make our, once he gives me the reference, we can make our summary statement.
Yeah? No, it's here.
Okay, so just because of time, I don't think you can find the reference, but we're going to summarize.
One second.
Yeah, okay. Do you want to make your closing statement and then I'll make my just in summary, what have you learned today and what are you going away with? And then, are you going to answer my question? My question is, Muhammad broke every single one of the Ten Commandments, okay? As we've seen, Muhammad took someone else.
Your interpretations, yes.
Okay, we saw that Allah caused divorce, even though God said you're not allowed to divorce. We saw that Allah caused Muhammad to take his son's wife.
Adopt his sons, yes.
Right? Even though it's not allowed, according to the Ten Commandments, under no circumstances are you to take your neighbor's wife. Whether your adopted son, whether your brother, whether your sister, whether your neighbor, whether you're a stranger, you can't take their wife. Right? It was punished over and over again. David, an important prophet of God, that God loved very much, he was punished. He was highly rebuked for taking somebody, Bathsheba's, someone else's wife, sorry, one second. Yeah? So, we see Allah is the one now instigating this. As Aisha said,
it said do not divorce. It shows his principles. It's one of the reasons why we follow him. But then it was revealed by someone who is more knowing than you, which is God. I did it for this purpose, to distinguish between the difference of son and adopted son. Yes? He said it on there, we read that. So that one, why I follow him due to his principles such as that. There you go, that's one of the reasons why I follow him. That's principle, that's my argument. And then you talked about adoption, how is, she said adoption's not allowed in Islam. When we know your team, the importance.
Is adoption allowed in Islam?
No. What about fostering?
Fostering,
yes.
But adoption is not allowed.
You can't change the name.
Somebody has a father, he has a lineage. His father,
but
the father,
but you,
is this.
Wait, you knew that. Why are you lying then?
No, we said earlier, you cannot change the name. You cannot change the name.
Who has a father, and you take him away from his father's name, and you give him you become the father.
We said that earlier.
Yeah.
So Islam says.
Why was adoption not allowed?
Yeah, simply because this person has a father, so you're denying him from his father.
It was because of this incident.
Yeah, this incident was
it
that.
Was this incident.
What's the incident?
The incident of Zayd.
Yeah,
and his wife.
Okay.
Is that correct?
No. Look, yes, it's correct.
Yes.
The incident. What happened is that basically.
Caused the beheading of 800 people that did nothing to this man, right? Because angel came. God, Allah, told him, go and kill them, you know? But we see that this Allah is not the same as the God of the Bible. He's not the same as the God of Jesus. He's not the same as the God of Moses. He's not the same as the same God we're all worshipping. It's not, because nowhere in the Bible does it justify adultery. Nowhere in the Bible does it justify stealing someone's wife. Nowhere in the Bible does it say divorce somebody because you lust after them. Nowhere in the Bible does it say kill, you know, kill people for the sake of killing them. Nowhere in the Bible that says kill people because they change their religion. But Muhammad says kill them if someone believes Islam, you know? But yet, we see Muslims justifying, like this brother was justifying all this evil act, evil, even though he admits that if it goes on in your own house, it wouldn't be nice. For somebody to come and cause your mum and dad to divorce, it would not be nice. For someone to come and rape your little child, it would not be nice. But yet, we see Muhammad doing this over and over again. But you, is there nothing in your conscience to tell you that there is something wrong with this Islam? Is there nothing in your conscience to tell you that there is something wrong with this guy, Muhammad? He's a bit...
Don't go too far.
You can complete it for yourself. There should be something in your conscience, Muslim, because on the day of judgment, God is going to ask you. God is going to say, you knew Jesus was sinless. Even your own prophet, even Allah says Jesus was sinless. But you rejected Jesus. You rejected the commandment of Jesus. And you followed a very sinful man over Jesus. God is going to ask you that.